Hey folks, we are done with day two of 3 days of the Reebok CrossFit Games Finals. I'm David Tao with BarBend.com. We're gonna be bringing you a day two recap as well as a leaderboard roundup heading into the final day of competition where we determine the fittest man and woman on earth for 2020. But before we do that, make sure you subscribe to BarBend on YouTube to stay up to date, not only in all things CrossFit Games, but also on competitions like the World's Strongest Man, the Olympics, the World Weightlifting Championships, you name it, we have you covered. If it's strength, BarBend is the place for you. On the women's side, heading into the final day of competition, Tia-Clair Toomey is your leader with 770 points, followed by Katherine David's daughter with 480, Carrie Pierce in podium position at 455, and then Haley Adams at 415, Brooke Wells rounding out the top five with 400 points. On the men's side, Matt Fraser pulling further ahead from the competition, your leader with 875 points. Following him is Canadian Jeffrey Adler with 440 points. And then Samuel Kwant also in podium position with 415 points. Followed by Justin Medeiros, the only rookie in this year's field with 395 points. Noah Olsen in fifth place, but tied with the same number of points as Medeiros with 395 points. So it's the latest CrossFit Games in history, the only one that's happened in the fall, but that doesn't seem to impact our reigning champions. And on day two of competition, both Matt Fraser and Tia-Clair Toomey started off where we're used to seeing them with event wins. On event six, the toast bar and lunge couplet, Matt Fraser takes a pretty commanding lead early on, very efficient on the toes to bar technique. Noah Olsen, a bit hot on his heels, but Fraser runs away with it in the last set of lunges, a relentless pace, and he's able to lunge with those heavy kettlebells across the finish line for another event victory. On the women's side, no surprise to see Tia-Clair Toomey do well in this workout. It's a classic sort of couplet, two movements that people are used to seeing, these CrossFit athletes are used to, although the lunges were a bit of a different variation. She had those two 53-pound kettlebells on her shoulders. She actually had some interesting technique here, and I don't mean on the toaster bar or the lunges. She placed her kettlebells basically right under the bar where she was doing the toaster bar so that she didn't have to double back after dropping off the kettlebells further downfield. She was the first competitor we saw figure out that technique. It saved her precious seconds and allowed her to take a bit of an advantage all those rounds over Katherine David's daughter, who finished in second place in event six. Now, the snatch speed ladder is an event that a lot of people were looking forward to because, well, we like seeing these athletes lift heavy weight and we like seeing them do it fast. Matt Fraser and Tia-Clair Toomey, no surprise, they won these events. They both have significant weightlifting experience. Fraser was an internationally competitive junior weightlifter. That's how he began his athletic career. And Tia-Clair Toomey was actually an Olympian in weightlifting in 2016, so no surprise there. Interesting kind of format. There were three consecutive rounds. The barbells got heavier with each round, and the last place finisher in each round was cut out. So on the first round of three snatches of that three snatch ladder, the fifth place finisher cut out. The second round, the fourth place finisher cut out. And so in the finals, there were only three competitors attempting barbells. On the women's side, Tia-Clair Toomey, no surprise that she won, but Ben Garvis, thanks for joining us in our Brooklyn studio. What did you see on the women's side in this snatch ladder that stood out to you?
Yeah, you know, I couldn't stop myself from comparing this to the 2015 event snatch speed ladder, which took a little bit less weight in 2015, but we saw a lot of these competitors coming back. One thing that really stood out to me was that Katherine Davis' daughter, who took second in 2015, dropped down the leaderboard. She ended up third this year. We saw Brooke Wells 29th in 2015, second this year. Tia-Clair Toomey 6th in 2015, jump up to first place.
And one thing we saw on the women's side is that Tia-Clair Toomey was power snatching those barbells heavier than any other female competitor. Now, she eventually did start squat snatching at that heavier weight, but a power snatch is gonna be a little bit quicker. The athlete's able to recover and bring their body to full extension quicker. That's gonna save seconds or even milliseconds on the transition from one barbell to the next. Tia-Clair Toomey leaning heavily on her Olympic lifting experience and her confidence with the barbell.
And she wasted almost no time dropping one barbell and heading straight up to the next one.
Grip it, rip it, you're gonna win an event. On the men's side in the snatch ladder, we saw a little bit more of a battle. In the finals, when it was just three men, we actually saw Jeffrey Adler briefly overtake Matt Fraser and just move a little bit ahead of him in one of the barbell transitions. But Fraser was actually able to win that event. Now, both Fraser and Adler missed attempts at 285. Fraser recovered first, had a successful attempt, and was the first to cross the finish line. Ben, another thing I really noticed about this workout was that Fraser was really quick on getting to the barbell, setting up, and making these attempts, whereas Adler, who Fraser was able to overtake, was a little bit slower on his setup, and that really counts for something.
And I was keeping my eye on Noah Olsen for this. We obviously watched him compete in 2015 in a similar event. He didn't do super well near the bottom of the leaderboard there. Here he was at the bottom of the leaderboard again today. He's going to desperately need some points heading into the remaining events.
The third event of day two was bike repeats. Now, the athletes had to bike down the field and back, and those were interrupted by legless rope climbs. This was reminiscent of a regionals workout from a few years back where the athletes had to sprint down and back the field of play, and then they had a legless rope climb. There were 10 rounds total. This was an event that was, you know, a bit over the 10-minute time domain. On the women's side, Tia-Clair Toomey got off to a pretty significant lead early on. Katrin David's daughter was hot on her heels for just a few rounds, but Toomey was able to extend that lead and come away with a pretty convincing event win. Haley Adams, just 19 years old and the youngest competitor in the field, still staying relevant with a second place finish. Now, as a spectator, this bike repeat event, even with the legless rope climbs thrown in, might not seem like the most exciting event to watch. It's pretty repetitive, 10 rounds of this stuff. But actually on the men's side, we ended up having one of the best races we've seen all weekend. Matt Fraser got out to an early lead. Justin Medeiros was hot on his heels for a few rounds. Medeiros drops back a little bit. Jeffrey Adler moves into second place position in the back half of the workout. And actually on rounds 9 and 10, we saw Adler significantly push Fraser, briefly overtake him on one of the bike straightaways. And Fraser had to go to another level to actually come away with an event win just a couple seconds ahead of Canadian Jeffrey Adler. Actually, after the event was over, after the athletes had crossed the finish line, we heard Matt Fraser on a mic basically say he had no idea Adler was that close or was even on the same round as him until that final round. It's a rare instance when we see Matt Fraser having to make up ground. It was actually reminiscent of the snatch ladder where Fraser had to overtake Adler on the final round. So Jeffrey Adler, even though he is not necessarily jockeying for that first place position, Fraser has that all but locked up at this point, he's definitely pushing Matt on a few of these workouts, and it's a lot of fun to watch. The final event of day two of this year's CrossFit Games finals was Happy Star. It was announced shortly before the actual event kicked off, what it would be, and it involved hill runs, it involved burpees over a beam, and it involved increasingly heavy thrusters at increasingly high reps. On the women's side, it was more of the same. Tia-Clair Toomey does what was once thought unthinkable and goes 4 for 4 on event wins for the day. Now, this event actually reminded me a little bit of event one from day one, where Brooke Wells got off to quite the lead and actually held that lead for about half of the event before being passed by Tia-Clair Toomey. Wells then struggled on the heavy thrusters at the end, which allowed two other competitors to pass her. And while she started out of the gates and started off on the runs very quickly in Happy Star, she had to settle for a fourth place finish overall. On the men's side, it was more of the same in that Matt Fraser matched his training partner Tia-Clair Toomey and comes away with his fourth event win on the day. 4 for 4 for Matt Fraser. Samuel Kwant actually started this workout in the lead. Fraser was able to overtake him and then never relinquished it after that. Fraser somehow made the increasingly heavy barbells look lighter and lighter as the event went on and just blew through them at the end. Kwant is able to hang on for a second place finish, but he had to dig deep. He was writhing on the ground afterward. He still makes up a little bit of ground. That's still a good finish for Kwant. Fraser, though, making it look routine. One thing worth noting is that day two of this year's CrossFit Games finals was a little lower on the volume than day one. There were 5 events in day one, including that brutal trail run. I caught up with Griffin Raleigh, who's one of the strongest CrossFitters on the planet and actually competed in stage one of this year's games. And he had some interesting things to say about the actual volume the athletes are facing this weekend and how it's going to impact their recovery.
Because not only is it like a lot of volume, but you got to think like the intensity. I loved day one. I absolutely loved it because it was heavy. It was fast, other than your trail run, right? But the mileage of like going up and down on your joints, and they definitely felt that today. Like Matt probably doesn't feel much half the time. He definitely woke up and felt that. I mean, because you train it, you do train that volume. And that's nothing new. But it's different when you're in competition going against the four other fittest guys in the world, and you just turned it up a notch.
Another thing that Griffin wanted to point out is that the high volume we're seeing in the finals this year might be the new normal we can expect from future iterations of the CrossFit Games.
You're gonna see this evolve into the next games, and it won't probably be maybe as much volume next time, but it's definitely gonna be close. Like if you, it just keeps increasing and increasing. So those guys were ready, but it was definitely a step up from the past games.
Bethany Shadburn is another CrossFit Games athlete I caught up with during day two, and she actually finished in the top 10 last year. And she wanted to point out that this is as much of a mental struggle as it is a physical struggle, especially given the high volume of work these athletes are required to perform.
I think for me personally is knowing that this stuff's gonna end. Because in the moment, sometimes it's hard because like you're in so much pain. Everyone's feeling the same way. That's the beauty of competition is like we're all hurting. Pain doesn't last forever. It's going to end. And the weekend's going to end too. So just knowing that should keep you like motivated to give all that you have during the events. We're all human and we all feel pain and it's freaking hard. And especially like if you're not recovering too, like that's the name of the game. Like if you can't recover throughout the weekend and you can't sleep because you're stressing about the workouts for tomorrow or whatever it is, or your body's just so inflamed that you just can't sleep, like all that stuff affects you. And we're superhuman, but there is still lots of pain that go on when we do these workouts.
And Ben, if Griffin's to be believed, this may be something that we should expect from the CrossFit Games moving forward. These very, very high volume days, especially if the fields are a bit smaller than what we've seen in years past.
It makes me think of Mary, a CrossFit event last year that is an AMRAP, as many reps and rounds as possible, nonstop work for 20 minutes. They put it at the end of a day last year to really just empty the gas tanks of the athletes.
Well, it seems like heading into day three, the rich get richer and our reigning champions extend their leads. Bethany Shadburn actually said there was something else to be observed from the game so far this year, and that's one athlete, Justin Medeiros, who she thinks could be the face of the men's side of the sport in years to come.
I've talked to him before and I knew that he was a great athlete, but for him to like hold his own with Matt, it's awesome to see. It is so cool and inspiring. I'm saying it now, like he's gonna be the next reigning champ, I think. Like if he can stay healthy, I mean, that's like the name of the game, right? Like being 21 and being so young, the world is ahead of you. And same with Haley. But for them, it's gonna be like making sure that you stay healthy for the next couple years.
Well, there you have it, a jam-packed day with a lot of podium movement, although the leaders stay the leaders and extend their leads. Matt Fraser and Tia-Clair Toomey putting on a clinic, 4 event wins each on the day. We'll be bringing you plenty of action for day 3 of competition where we determine the podium finishers from the 2020 CrossFit Games. Until then, I'm David Tao with BarBend.com. Special thanks to our guests, Ben Garvis, Bethany Shadburn, and Griffin Raleigh for joining in today.